Good morning and welcome to worship at Tusculum Baptist Church. Let's begin with a word of prayer. Father, thank you for this great day. Thank you for this time that we can worship together. Thank you, Lord, for our freedoms in America. As this holiday weekend, we celebrate the founding of this nation. And Lord, we come with concerns as well as celebration. We have concerns about the health of America and our world. We have concerns about not just the physical health, but the relational health of people getting along with one another. And we need your help, and we need your strengthening of this nation. We need a revival. We need a turning back to you, Lord. I pray for spiritual awakening in America and around the world. And we pray, Lord, that you would begin that by working in our lives through this time of worship today. Lord, we know that you are a personal God and you speak to us in personal ways. And that's where spiritual change really begins, one at a time, as we turn to you in new and fresh ways and worship you. So, Lord, we just we are grateful for many things, but we also bring our concerns and our burdens before you. And we pray that you'd use this worship experience today to strengthen us in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, it's great that we can worship together again this way. And I just wanted to mention several things. We have added to our schedule Wednesday night prayer meetings, and the student gathering is in the CFC gym. And so that's at 6:30 on Wednesday nights. And we are able to spread out and social distance well. And we've had some great prayer time. So even if you are not comfortable coming or cannot come, you can be praying with us at the same time, and we can be joined together even as on Sundays we worship in many different places in our homes, but also at the church at 11 o'clock. There's an opportunity to serve others at the Tabernacle Mission Soup Kitchen on the 5th Wednesday of July. That'll be the 29th. And if you're interested in helping, you can email the church and let us know of your interest. And they're doing some things differently, as all things in food service are. They're preparing box lunches that are picked up by people in the community and so on. But they still need help with that. So we would appreciate that. Next Sunday, we're going to be recognizing in our 11 o'clock service our high school graduates and honoring them. And so we have some other great things coming up, a baptism later in the month of July. So it's great worshiping with you today, and I hope that you're encouraged by joining in with us.
More than love. invite us again.
So for today's scripture reading, we're going to be reading in 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verses 11 through 16. And you can follow along in your Bibles if you'd like. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verses 11 through 16. So Solomon finished the Lord's temple in the royal palace. Everything that had entered Solomon's heart to do for the Lord's temple, for his own palace, succeeded. Then the Lord appeared to Solomon at night and said to him, "I have heard your prayer and have chosen this place for myself as a temple of sacrifice. If I shut the sky so there is no rain, or if I command the grasshopper to consume the land, or if I send pestilence on my people, and my people who bear my name and humble themselves, pray and seek my face, and turn from their evil ways, then I will hear from heaven, forgive their sin, and heal their land. My eyes will now be open and my ears attentive to prayer from this place. And I have now chosen and consecrated this temple so that my name may be there forever. My eyes and my heart will be there at all times." Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you that yesterday, Lord, we celebrated our freedom, Lord, our independence that we have here in America. And Lord, we think about the different freedoms that we have here and the choices that we make. But ultimately, Lord, we think about the freedom that we have in you, the freedom in Christ. And Lord, I pray that we would always remember this freedom that we have in you, because you've freed us, Lord, from sin. You've taken away our sin. But Lord, we know that there are people, maybe people in our family or in friends, that Lord are still in bondage in sin. And Lord, knowing that we have the good news that we can share. And I pray that you would help us to do that, to share the good news, and knowing that they can be free in you. And so, Lord, we thank you for this time. We thank you for this time of worship. In your name I pray. Amen.
Please look in your Bible with me at the book of 2 Chronicles, chapter 7, 11 through 16. the Old Testament book of 2 Chronicles, chapter 7, verses 11 through 16. We'll be doing several messages in a brief series called Opening Doors to Spiritual Awakening. And today we're looking at God's ways to revival. Many people ask today, what's wrong with America? Many Christian people have the perspective of, why can't there be a spiritual awakening, a revival that will turn people back to God? But what do people really imagine when they talk about a spiritual awakening? Many times there's obviously the spiritual benefits and the return of passion and excitement about God, but also I think sometimes people are thinking about the preservation of the comforts and the prosperity of our nation. Many people think of the good old days of many years ago and the way things were, or just a few months ago before the pandemic began and it affected our ways of life and our economy, and many have lost jobs and things like that. Some people imagine revival as not only a closer relationship with God, but there's certain side benefits. There's the protection of our security, of our financial affluence, and that maybe it's a cure for the anxieties that people have about their future and their goals in life. I think it's true that millions of Americans are praying for spiritual awakening during these times that we live in today. But we must ask ourselves, if we're asking God to save our society and the souls of people, are we concerned about the spiritual condition of the people of our nation and world, or are we really troubled more about the things that have changed for us and the things that maybe are uncertainties for us about our economic well-being and our comfortable ways of life? Historically, great revivals and awakenings have changed society and the culture that people live in. And during those historic times, it was during hard times that these revivals began that swept the land. And it was when survival was the main thought and not prosperity. The late Soviet dissenter and Christian writer Alexander Solzhenitsyn wrote these words from a Soviet prison. He said, "The meaning of earthly existence is not, as we have grown used to thinking, in prosperity, but in the development of the soul. Commitment to Jesus Christ requires a genuine repentance, to give up what we have, a desire to change. Losing our lives for Christ's sake is not any more popular today than it was in the first century when he gave that challenge to first century disciples who would live for him." And so we must ask ourselves, what are our true desires when we think about spiritual awakening? Many of these thoughts I've shared are from the late Chuck Colson, some of his writings. But I think that these words are perhaps more relevant today than they were when Colson wrote them 15 years or so ago. People have many different understandings of the term revival. If you look in the dictionary and try to find the meaning of the word, there are many different meanings. It means a bringing back into use, or a restoration of activity, a bringing back to life or consciousness, a stirring up of religious feelings, usually by the excited preaching of evangelists at public meetings. That's the one I like. That sounds like a definition of an outsider looking in, but it's talking about the animation of the preacher. But revival is a rekindling of spiritual closeness with God and the experience of his power. We can experience forgiveness of sins and a revival of closeness with God when we do the things that God says bring about real revival. About 3,000 years ago, King Solomon was king in Israel. And one of the greatest accomplishments of his rule was that he built the temple for Israel. It had been the desire of his father David, but it wasn't God's plan for David to build it, but Solomon built the temple. And when the temple was being dedicated, Solomon prayed in a prayer of dedication, and God responded and spoke to him in an audible voice where he could hear what God had to say. And God was speaking about the future of the land and of the people. And the Lord gave some clear steps to revival if and when the people strayed away from God. God knew that it was going to happen sooner or later. He said that there would be divine judgment that would come on the nation in the form of drought and locusts that would devour their crops and diseases. And this type of thing, knowing that historically, gets our attention in today's time. But God also promised to send spiritual revival if the people would turn back. But notice the word if. It is a conditional promise. And he said that he would bring about spiritual blessings on them, but also he would heal their land, meaning primarily agriculturally, because the agriculture would be decimated, and that would mean that the economy would be wrecked. But verse 14 has often been applied to America. You sometimes see it on billboards. You're driving down interstates about a kind of a call to bring us back to the Lord. When God said, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. But in its context, this was not about America. It was about Israel. It was about the people of God who were in a covenant relationship with God. And so the statement applied to them long ago, but I believe, biblically speaking, it applies to God's people, the church, today. It does not apply to America in a general way, because Americans are not God's people unless they have individually made a commitment to Jesus Christ and chosen to follow him as the Lord and leader of their life. Nations cannot be Christian. Only individuals can be Christian. And so we need to understand that revival must begin in the church. And if it begins in the church, it must begin with you and with me. And so with that in mind, what requirements did God give for revival? To open doors for spiritual awakening, we must take the following steps for spiritual revival. And the first one is we must humble ourselves. We must humble ourselves. The Lord said, when I shut up the heavens so that there is no rain, or command locusts to devour the land, or send a plague among my people, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves. That's the first thing that he says. God identifies his people as my people who are called by my name. This literally means those upon whom my name has been placed. God had marked Israel and set them apart his very own by putting his name upon them. They were his treasured people based on their dependence on him, their faith in him, and their obedience to God's commands. The church today has a faith covenant with God through Jesus that results in obedience to God's word that instructs us on how to live and worship. So the first thing that we think about when we think about revival, though, it's not humbling ourselves. We think about praying. That's the first thing, and that's a good thing, but it's not in the order God gave. God says the first thing to do is to humble ourselves. And so, you know, we've been studying in 1 Peter in the last few weeks, and we saw this theme of humility, and the last message was that was what it was all about, but it's all through the book. And we saw that to live out the message of 1 Peter, it requires humility, and sometimes that's seen in submission, submission to God, submission to one another, submission to leadership, and so on. But the word humble that's used in the Old Testament comes from the root word that means literally to bow the knee, to fall on one's knees. So to humble oneself is to submit to God. This humility was put into action through obedience to God. That's how it was expressed, especially in that Old Testament time. We think of humility as an attitude, and it is, but it's also a choice, it's a decision that leads to action, and that's very important. We saw that last week as we studied about humility and how Jesus humbled himself by becoming obedient to death on a cross. In 1981, a Canadian high school dropout named Chris Haney partnered with a journalist friend, Scott Abbott, to invent a board game called Trivial Pursuit. By today, it's estimated that this board game has exceeded $1 billion in sales. It became more popular than Monopoly. The original game had 6,000 trivia questions on 1,000 cards coded by categories like history and entertainment. Then there were other variations from this, not apart from the invention of these originators, but there was like Bible trivia. And that's a game that I've enjoyed through the years. A lot of people thought I would do really well on it, but it always made me nervous that if I play this game that I wasn't going to do very well. And honestly, I haven't done very well with it because they find some very obscure information to create the Bible trivia questions. But that makes a pastor look kind of bad when you do poorly at Bible trivia. Well, here's a Bible trivia question for you. What people in Scripture are called the scum of the earth? Well, would it be the Pharisees? Would it be the Romans who oppressed Jewish people? The immoral? Murderers? No, none of those. In 1 Corinthians 4:13, Paul said the apostles were called the scum of the earth. It means the dregs or the refuse of the world. Now, who would talk about that if that was a description of derision that other people had for you? You wouldn't want to talk about it, but the apostles did because they saw that description given by the world as a badge of honor. They humbled themselves and were willing to suffer insult and ridicule for the glory of God and for the gospel. There was a time when Paul was known as Saul of Tarsus, and he was a persecutor of the church. But another thing is that he had this works religion, and he had earned in his thinking and the thinking of others in the Jewish establishment that he was a champion, that he was one who was good in his works. He trusted in his good works. We as Christians today, though, must be careful that we don't assess ourselves too highly. We know that we're sinners saved by grace. We grow and change, and God does a work of transformation in us, but we must not think too highly of ourselves by being impressed with our goodness. Whatever good is in us is something that is a result of the transformational work of Jesus in us. After all, Paul later said, late in his life, that he was the worst of sinners. He saw with humility himself and assessed himself accordingly. The example of the apostles was that they had no ambitions outside of Christ. They didn't have career plans other than being a faithful follower of Jesus who did the things he had instructed them to do. They surrendered themselves to him as Lord. They were willing to be slandered. They were willing to give up possessions, to give up jobs. And they didn't care what people thought about them. They only cared about what Jesus thought. They had died to themselves and to the world. And that's why they were not conflicted about being obedient to the Lord. Humility leads to obedience. And I think this is an overlooked key to revival. The first step to revival is to humble ourselves. And then a second thing we see is that we must pray for awakening. God said, "If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray." The basic meaning for the word pray in Hebrew is to prostrate oneself before God seeking his favor. We think of someone down on their face before God. The word is interesting because the meaning contains two ideas, to judge and to intercede. So when we pray, God's people judge themselves as guilty of sin, and they intercede, they ask God for forgiveness and for him to restore his blessings. And so after we humble ourselves, we are to pray with this idea of self-examination in our lives as we judge ourselves guilty and then ask God for his blessings and his restoration of the spiritual closeness with him in our relationship with him. The second Great Awakening in America happened in 1792. It had its beginnings, though, about 5 years earlier in 1787 on the campus of Hampton Sidney College in Virginia. Three students were concerned about the moral condition of the campus and the other students, and they decided they would pray for revival, for some kind of spiritual awakening on campus once a week. And they went out into the woods to pray. Other students found out about it, and they made fun of them. But the president of the college also found out about it, and he invited them to his house to have their prayer meeting there. Then other students joined in with them, and it gained momentum as they were praying for spiritual awakening on their campus. And the next school year, 200 students gave their lives to Jesus Christ. And this campus revival spread to other campuses around America during this colonial period of time. At Yale University, Timothy Dwight, who was the grandson of Jonathan Edwards, Edwards was the leader of the first Great Awakening 60 years earlier, and Dwight became the president at Yale University, and he saw the rampant unbelief on the campus and was very troubled about this, and he began to preach the gospel powerfully, and by 1802, one-third of the student body at Yale had been saved. Revival continued to spread. It spread to Kentucky and other parts of the frontier of the new nation. And the awakening greatly affected society in those early years. And where did it all begin, though? It started with three students who were concerned about their campus, and they prayed, going out into the woods for a prayer meeting. That's where it all began. The prayer of the revived is, whatever the price, whatever the cost, I'm available. Use me anytime, in any way, any place. Do it your way, Father God. And that was the heart cry of these young people. It's been said that the church of today is poverty-stricken in terms of prayer. People volunteer as players and some as payers, but few want to be prayers. The prayer meeting of churches is the smallest gathering before or after coronavirus. It's that you can hardly get people together to pray. And so we need to see that God is calling us to pray. And think of this. We're right across the street from a college. And what if God would use us in this setting to be those who would ignite a fire revival in the hearts of students, or students would ignite that fire revival in our hearts as they had a concern praying for spiritual awakening. In our, it could spread across the whole land. It could spread across the world like these great awakenings did in the past, and we need an awakening today. This is a reality about the spiritual life. A sinning person will stop praying, but a praying person will stop sinning. Now, that's not to say a person becomes in a condition of sinless perfection, but obviously the more we are in tune with God, the better we're going to live our lives in faithfulness for him. So I've been thinking about this, and we have some limitations about the coronavirus and so on, but maybe there's creative ways you and I could come up with to encourage people to pray. So I would encourage you to pray about that. How could you pray more, and how could you encourage others to pray more? Maybe you'll go back to what we talked about 15 minutes more of focus on God. We've talked about that early this year, and a number of people were encouraged by that. Maybe you would pray 15 minutes more for awakening, for people to be saved, for people who have drifted away from God to come back into fellowship. And maybe we could use technology and other means of communication that we could call people into prayer, even at their homes, but in focused times. So give it some thought. God may use you to stir up others through an idea that you have. We must pray for a revival for our souls individually. We must pray for our church. We must pray for revival in our community and in our land and in our world. And God can use us to make a difference through prayer. So we must humble ourselves, first of all, and then we must pray for awakening. And then the third thing that we're told here is we must seek God's face. Seek God's face. The Lord said, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face. The word seek means to inquire, to examine, to search for by touching. There's an interesting nuance of meaning in the Hebrew words. It is necessary to get closer to make a search like that. You can't stay far away from God. We're to search out God by touching him. This word contains the idea of searching until one finds. Seeking God's face is stated in the context of seeking revival, of returning to God. And this means to search after God in humility and prayer until one finds favor with God again. You may have heard of the evangelist David Ring. I heard him preach many years ago in a large conference center when I lived in Texas. And then I heard him again a second time. And as I recall some things about this, there's some interesting lessons I think that can help us. David Ring has a great testimony. He was born with cerebral palsy, and it has affected his speech. And the first time I heard him, being honest about it, I had trouble understanding him. And I think I had trouble understanding for two reasons. One is I probably wasn't listening closely enough. And secondly, I was seated very far away and I couldn't see him very well. But the second time I heard him speak, I sat close to the front and I could see his face as he talked and I had no trouble understanding him at all. You know, I think it's that way with God sometimes. Often we don't hear him. It may be because we're not listening very well. But it also may be that we're not close enough to truly understand what he is saying. So I have a question for you today. Are you within hearing distance of God? Is that how you're living your life? Are you close to him? Are you able to hear him? We can't come and see his face like we can see the face of others, like you're seeing my face at this time. But we can see what he's revealed about himself. He's revealed his character. He's revealed his ways. And he's given us his word. And as we interact with his word, we can see the Lord and understand his plans and purposes for us. We need to be like Job, who said, I have treasured the words of his mouth more than my daily bread. Does that describe you and me, honestly? Do we treasure God's word more than our food? Here might be the problem in this step of revival of seeking God's face. I think that we as people, if we're honest about it, we have to admit that we have a tendency to seek God's hand more than God's face. When we seek God's hand, you know what? We want something from him. We want his hand to move in power. We want him to do something for us. And we have many things we pray about that we want him to do for us. But when you seek his face, you just long to be in his presence. You want to understand him. You want to hear from him. You want to know what it is that he wants us to do. And that's a lot different from just focusing on wanting God's hand. And so we need to enter into his presence, turning from our sin and humility so that we can respond to him in faith. Verses 15 and 16, we often don't read this part, but it says, now my eyes, God is speaking, now my eyes will be open, my ears attentive to the prayers offered in this place. I have chosen and consecrated this temple so that my name may be there forever. My eyes and my heart will always be there. Now, this is an important element to seeking his face. It's worship. Now, God was saying that the temple in the Old Covenant was the focus or focal place of their worship. But yet a person could worship wherever they were. But we know in the church age especially that we are the church gathered at various times at the church building, but we're also scattered, especially in these present circumstances. But it doesn't matter. It comes down to worship. Because you can gather in the place of worship and not really worship. It comes back to your heart attitude. We must seek his face. We must express our love to him. We must receive from him guidance so that we can be the people he wants us to be. So we must humble ourselves. We must pray for awakening. We must seek his face. And the last thing he tells us that is a step for revival, we must repent of our sins. In verse 14, he said, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Repent means to turn away from one's sins. It involves a change of direction, a change of one's mind. And this idea of turning that's used in the Hebrew terminology here has a twofold meaning. It means to cease from an evil way, but also to return to God, return to obedience to God. In the historical context, when God said this to Solomon, he was probably concerned about the people compromising spiritually and embracing the practices of the Canaanite peoples around them, which were pagan in religious nature and immoral in various objectionable practices. And so there were sins of idolatry that we know, the history of Israel, they got involved in these things. When we think about today, there are many people in America who claim to be born-again Christians. Recent research, in fact, this number has come down through the years, but recent research is that 35% would claim to be born-again Christians. Some people don't really understand the term. They think it's a political term or evangelical is a political term. It's not. It's a description of a biblical Christianity that is true in discipleship. But yet, if that many people in America claim to be Christian, why do we still see the disintegration of the family, even in Christian families? We still have violent crime. We have pornography that is available on the internet and other means just about for any age person. We have immoral agendas that are forced upon us. I was watching something on the Cartoon Channel with my grandchildren, and I couldn't believe the advertisement that I saw that was forcing an agenda of redefinition of the family on children. Racism continues. Abortion has become a legalized industry, and 40% of babies born in America are born to unmarried people. So we see these things that are symptoms of spiritual problems in America, but if millions of people are Christians, why is it that we don't have the impact maybe that we once had in America? Why is Christianity seemingly having little influence on society? It might be because we have religion without repentance. There's a lot of people who will confess their sins. They'll admit they do things wrong, but they don't give them up. They don't forsake them. They don't change. There's no turning back to God in obedience. And if there's no repentance, folks, there's no forgiveness. There's no restoration of the closeness with God. Historically, spiritual awakenings have influenced society, and a revived church changes the morality and the values of a culture all around them. But I think many people, even Christians, think that definitions of sin have changed with the changing of time. It's the 21st century. No one looks at things that, like they used to, people will say, and they'll excuse their sin by saying things like that. But just as there can be no salvation without repentance, there can be no spiritual power in an unrepentant church. The church today suffers from a lack of obedience, not a lack of available power. God's power is available if we will do the things that he says. If we will honor these steps to revival, we can experience his presence and his power. But we must turn to God in total faith and dependence on him. As I've mentioned, this promise for awakening is conditional. We see it in the latter part of verse 14. If we do these things, humble ourselves, pray, if we seek his face and we repent, he said, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Our land needs healing spiritually, relationally, and physically with this virus that is around. And you and I can open the doors to spiritual awakening. And it must start somewhere. It must start with someone. Why not us? If we will decide to take these simple steps, God's way to revival, and to live them out, humbling ourselves, praying for awakening, seeking God's face, and repenting of our sins. But it comes down to this: what will you decide to do, and what will I decide to do? I read the story of some missionaries that were in a jungle area doing some work with people's groups in that area, and they were out from, they camped near a colony of monkeys. And they would see the monkeys all around and so on. But they were out and visiting these different people groups. And they came in one late afternoon. And they saw the monkeys scurrying all around their camp in obvious imitation of the missionaries. They had gathered up sticks and piled them together as if it were firewood. And they were sitting around the sticks as if they were warming themselves, like the missionaries did at night. It was a comical thing. All they lacked was the fire. You know what? I think a lot of times in the church today, we have lots of activity. We do lots of things. We gather in certain places. We get our resources together. And the only thing we lack is the fire of the Holy Spirit to really empower the church and ignite our faith in new ways with new passion so that we go out and we live in the community and in our everyday world in a way to make a difference for Him. We need awakening. It has to start with God's people, and then it can spread to others. We can open the doors to awakening, but we must desire the fire of the Holy Spirit to ignite us new and afresh so that we can make a difference in our world. I hope that you'll join me in a desire for awakening and that we would humble ourselves and pray and seek God's face and repent of our sins so that we can be the people of God in the world as He's called us to be on mission for Him. Will you bow with me for a time of reflection and prayer? So these are simple steps that we can take, seeking God, being faithful, being what He wants us to be. Will you decide today that you will let revival begin in you? Don't wait passively for something to happen outside of yourself. It happens from within when we sincerely come before the Lord and trust Him to work in our lives in new and fresh ways. Father, thank you for your presence. Thank you for the reality that we can experience revival when we turn to you. Lord, I pray for each one watching today. I pray that you will encourage them and speak to them, and that with all of us, whether we're gathering in person at the church building or scattered in our homes, that we might experience revival and that we might share it with others, that we'll find creative ways to include others and to get others to pray with us for awakening, that we might make a difference in our world for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, in a moment, Zachary's going to come and lead us in our closing song. And then before he does that, though, there's a few questions that are on the outline that's posted on the website that you can reflect on. And they're going to be on the screen next. And then Zachary will lead us in the closing song. This is Amazing Grace, and it's a great song of encouragement. So then I'll come back with a few final words before we close today.
the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. I sing for all that you've done for me.
Let's sing together. Worthy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Oh, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Oh, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Oh, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. I sing for all that you've done for me. Oh, Jesus. Whoa, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Well, each week when we meet in person, we use a communication card for prayer requests and ways that we can help. And even though you're watching from a distance, you can call us at the church or you can email us. The information is there on the website. And let us know how we can help you and how we can pray for you. We would really like to do that. So please be in touch. Thank you for supporting the church financially by giving online or mailing in your offerings or dropping them off at church. That's been a blessing, and that is a help. And then remember that there's also the link to the Team Kid study for children that Justin has prepared, and I hope that you are encouraged. So let us know how we can be a blessing to you or help you, and God bless you. Have a great week.